Welcome back to the session. This is Mrs. Ida Joycey, Assistant Professor, St. Joseph's College of Arts and Science, Cuddalore, Tamil Nadu, India. I am happy to meet you all once again in this video class. Today we are going to discuss a prose topic, The Figure a Poem Makes, written by Robert Frost. We all know who is Robert Frost, but still to start with, let me tell you something about Robert Frost. As we all know, he is one of the major 20th century modern American poet. He is equal to Wordsworth of England. All his poems reveal the aspects of nature, and this shows his oneness with nature. By closely observing nature, he learns his lesson, and he ends all his poems with a message. As he has rightly pointed out in this essay, the poems of Robert Frost, they begin in delight and they end in wisdom. They bring about a clarification of life. And Frost was one of the poets who had impressed Jawaharlal Nehru, the former Prime Minister of India. And he was Jawaharlal Nehru, in his table he had the four prominent lines written by Frost in the poem, Stopping by Woods on a Snowy Evening. So the lines are, the woods are lovely, dark and deep, but I have promises to keep, and miles to go before I sleep, and miles to go before I sleep. This poem, these poetic lines seem to have inspired Jawaharlal Nehru to a greater extent all through his life. So such a lovely poet is Robert Frost. This simple essay, The Figure a Poem Makes, speaks about the art of composing a poem. We can divide the entire prose piece into four different sections. In the first part, he talks about where lies the greatness of a poem. What should become the best part of a poem? The constituents. What are the elements of a good poem? This is what he discusses in the first section of the essay. In the second section, he talks about the art of writing it. The experience of writing the poem, which is a delight, which is a surprise both for the poet himself as well as to the readers. And he says it is not a trick poem, it takes its own course. Every poem takes its own course, and in fact the first line is only the conscious effort made by the poet. In the next part, he goes on to talk about where lies the delight. And he talks about what should be the freedom of the artist. The artist should have freedom of the material to talk about anything through the vast experience he had lived through his time. And it is the discovery of the long lost past experience that gives him the most suitable content to deal with in a poem. That becomes the best subject matter for writing a poem. And in the final phase of the essay, he says what is the freshness, what can be considered the freshness of a poem, what can make the poem immortal. He says a poem should never rust away, it should not become rotten, it should always have the freshness. And to retain this freshness, the poet should have composed it most originally. And the originality of the poem assigns freshness to the poem, that the readers will never get tired of reading such a beautiful poem. And he says, even reading it for 100 times, even in the 100th reading, a reader can find meaning if a poem is original. So to start with, he says, poetry of the 20th century. He is talking about the modern poets. He calls them scholars. He calls them humanists. He is calling them to be abstractionists. He is calling them as philosophers. And he says, in the modern times, in the 20th century, poetry has become like a toy in the hands of the artist. The 20th century artists, here the artists refer to the poets. They consider poetry, the art of writing a poem has become like a plaything. They play with it and they give their lives for it. This speaks about the utter dedication with which poets compose poems. And the first element of a poem is sound. He calls sound as the gold in the ore. So out of the raw materials, out of the raw constituents like vowels, consonants, syllables, syntax, rhythm, the sound is the most important element. Sound here refers to the meaning, the context, the theme or the subject matter of poetry. Sound alone can make the poem meaningful. He says it is better always a poem is sound. A poem can be sound or unsound, but Frost advises, he advocates that a poem should be a sound poem because it is written after an experience which is very deep and touching. And in the second part he says, in the choice of the sound or the theme or the wildness in making the poem unique, poet is composing thousands or hundreds of poems, yet it is obligatory on the part of the poet to make himself free from monotony. He should not be stereotyped. He should never give the chance for the audience to judge what the poem is going to be about or what is going to be the climax of the poem. So every poem should be new, it should be fresh, it should be sound enough, and it should be a matter of suspense and thrill to uncover the hidden meaning of poetry. So that is the task of the poem. So making a poem sound. So the first element, the most precious part of the poem, is the theme of the poem, which he says that sound is the gold in the ore. The second element of poetry is wildness. Wildness is some strange, bizarre, odd, peculiar representation of ideas. So when we say that a poetry should be a strange representation, it should not mislead or it should not perplex or confuse the readers. There should be wildness, there should be some strangeness. At the same time, there should be a subject matter that has to be fulfilled within the wildness of poetry. And so the second element of a poem is wildness. This wildness, he says, it is the better half of sound. If you consider sound as the first important element of the poem, the second equal constituent or component of a poem is wildness. So if it is plainly said, then it becomes a prose poem. If it is a wild representation, then it is a song, it is a music, it is a rhythm. It gives vibrating sensation to the audience who are able to derive the message. And he says to make this poem both sound and wild, the poet finds difficulty in the choice of the subject matter. And to choose the subject matter or the theme of the poem, the poet, his mind, it jumps from one chance suggestion to another. And Robert Frost, he is comparing this dilemma and the oscillation in the mind of the poet to that of a grasshopper on a hot afternoon. So a grasshopper on a hot sunny afternoon, left in the open fields, it will never be at rest. It is completely restless, jumping from one direction to the other, unless and until it finds a shady place. So there are plenty of chance suggestions that arises in the mind of the poet, and ultimately the poet arrives at one particular subject matter. This theme or the subject matter steadies down the mind of the poet. Then he begins to write the poem, and he says, as the poet begins, his pleasure, his delight, the ecstasy is similar to that of a lover a lover who has fallen in love for the first time. He inclines automatically to the impulse and he is totally carried away by the impulse. So it is his self-discovery from delight to wisdom. Similar to that of a lover, the poet also, as he is conscious only to write only the first line of the poem, the rest of the lines follow by itself. Say for example, if a poet is going to describe Mount Himalayas, he need not be literally be there on the spot, but mentally he already had created an image of a snow-covered mountain that allows him, though within his study room, in his own study desk, he is already there in the scenery describing the glory and the beauty of the mountain Himalaya. So only the first line of the poem is consciously laid, and no poem is a preconceived effort of the poet, because every poem takes its own lucky course, which is similar to that of the joy of a lover. And it is in this process that every poem begins in delight and it ends in wisdom. And where really lies the delight or the happiness for the poet is, the poet all of a sudden he remembers something from his past, and that which was most useless according to him becomes the best part of the poet. And against such a worthless experience, the poet finds a line of purpose. He is able to construct a beautiful line against that singled out absurd experience. So the poet, what is his task is, he takes something of the past, something clinging from somewhere in his past life, he brings it to the present, he is trying to make it into a beautiful poem, and it becomes a message for the future. So from the past he carries forward his experience to the future, and by making his poem sound out of his experience, the poem becomes a compact containment of meaning and message for the posterity. And to achieve this delight, and when a poem is written in such a manner, the poem is both a surprise for the poet himself as well as to the readers. No tears in the poet, no tears in the reader. So whatever is the emotion of the poet, that becomes the emotion of the audience. And the success of the poet lies in making his emotions become the emotions of the audience as well. So he is successful in his art and craft only in the effective manner in which he is able to convey or communicate or express his emotion to that of the audience side. So to achieve this effect in poetry, a poet has to be given the complete freedom of the material. So he should be free from the bias of religion or politics or society or gender, and he should be free to talk about anything from the past chaos of all that he has lived through. And this freedom of the material would allow the poet have his own imagination grown. His imagination takes wings with the first line of the poem laid consciously by the poet. And we can also find when a poem is written in such a original manner, there is also logic, and this logic also contains a wildness. So where lies wildness in the logic is, it is not always that you begin to read the first line proceeding to the last line, even when you are going to read it in the retrospect, from backward to the first line, in the reverse order, even then you will find there is a link of coherence. You will find that poem retains still the meaning, and it contains the original mood of the poet. And in next part, he speaks about the knowledge that is gained by the artist. He is making a comparison between the scholars and the artist. Scholars, they get their knowledge very consciously through thoroughness of logic. They do it as an assignment. But a poet or an artist for that matter, he does not take up anything as his assignment. he is able to learn in and out of books. So learning from the books, in the books is able to grasp his knowledge from the books, and out of the books, that is by his experience. So the way he is able to grasp knowledge is quite casual and cavalierly, and it is similar to that of the burrs that stick on to yourself when you walk across the field. So he is not making an acquirement or possession of knowledge. Nothing is self-assignment. He does not command himself to acquire knowledge, but it is quite a cavalier fashion in which an artist gains knowledge. And similarly, if you are going to ask a scholar or a school child to say something what he has read from a book, he would repeat the same, not changing the order in which it has been written. That is the way with a school child. If you are going to do the same with a poet, he learns something from somewhere, but he produces it in a different order, more creatively and originally, without showing that it is clinging to somewhere anything else in the past. This is supposed to be the style of the poet. The poet should make his piece of a poem original, creative, and there should be a novelty in the composition of the poem. And a poem which is composed in such a manner is very spontaneous. And this effortless endeavor of the poet to compose a poem is compared to that of a piece of ice. You place an ice cube on hot stove, it melts on its own writing. So a poem, after the first line is written, it should go by itself. It should carry the poet along with the course of the poem. That should be the methodology, that should be the naturalness, the spontaneity in writing a poem. So this is what even Wordsworth says: poetry is a spontaneous overflow of emotions recollected in tranquility. So in tranquil mood, when a poet sits down, he should be spontaneous enough. There should be some naturalness in composing a poem, and it should not be a deliberate effort. A poem need not be buried into being. You cannot make a poem, you can only compose the first line of a poem, which completes by itself using the imagination of the poet. And when a poem is written in such a manner, he says, a poem is fresh. That can give freshness to the poem. If the poem is original, the poem contains its freshness, which is similar to that of the petals of a flower. So a petal of a flower, even when you detach it, it will never lose its fragrance. So a poem, even when you are going to read it 100 times, you will always find new meanings at every sitting to read the poem. That we call it to be the freshness of the poem. And such a poem can surely take you to a great clarification of thought. It is a clarification both for the poet and for the reader. It is not necessarily wisdom. It can give you a stay away from confusion. It can give you delight, and through the journey of delight, it can lead you to a great state of wisdom. So this is what Robert Frost discusses in this poem, The Figure a Poem Makes. Thank you all.